So I thought I would start a talk about glaciers in the past by showing a picture of a modern glacier. This is the Upsala Glacier in Chile. I mean, at the head of Lago Argentino, coming off the South Patagonian ice field, which overlaps both countries. And I thought I would just spend one slide just introducing what I do, the type of research I do, and who I am. Well, you know my name, but just my background. I say I'm an observation-based researcher. This actually came up in Peter's talk where he mentioned this, and what this means, or the way I think it means, is my research is really based on gathering data and observations, and this is for comparison. You know, people who do computer modeling of glaciers, or people have heard of climate models to predict climates. My research is really grounded in obtaining new observations. I consider myself a geologist or an earth scientist, so I use the geologic record, and I'll talk about this a little bit more, on what glaciers and ice sheets and climate have done in the past, specifically before, you know, human effects over the last 100 years or so. I do a lot of field work, and what I mean by field work is I go to a lot of places with terrible views around the world, although it rains a lot. I usually show pictures of us getting drenched by rain so people don't get too envious. And I collect both observations and evidence, and then more important, samples to bring back to analyze in the laboratory. My research is also very, with colleagues such as Esteban, very heavily based on laboratory work. So going into the field, getting samples, which I'll talk about more in the next few minutes, bringing them back to the laboratory and analyzing them in a way I'll explain in a few minutes. And, you know, for grant applications and including the Fulbright application, what we usually say is we're providing data or new observations to test hypotheses on how climates have varied in the past. So why do we care about glaciers or past climates? Well, in a modern context, that's obvious to everyone here why we care about glaciers. Water resources and cultural significance. I want to highlight that as I'll explain in the next few minutes, my expertise is not on modern glaciers or what our predictions of what glaciers will do. And I'll come back to that actually in the last slide. But my expertise and experience is more on learning about glaciers and climate in the past. So why is it important to learn about the past? It's obvious why we want to know the present, but the past, what we like to say is in the past there have been a bunch of natural laboratory experiments, or natural experiments, if you will, on what glaciers and climates have done. So if we look through geologic records or other type of records, we can learn what changed glaciers and what were the natural climate variability in the past under different, and what may have caused those changes. And this will help us learn more about how climate varies on its own before, let's say, human influences. As an example, as geologists, we can ask, when we look at the past, is it anomalous what's happening now? Were there other times in the past where glaciers waxed and waned and were of small size? And what were the causes, potential causes or hypotheses on what may have caused glaciers to be small in the past before humans had a big effect? And one of the believe it or not, there's still a lot of major gaps in knowledge about how climate and glaciers have varied in the past. So a lot of ultimate justification for the work is to fill in these major gaps in understanding how glaciers even changed in the past, and as a context for the present, and what may have caused those changes. So you may have heard of other ways to reconstruct or learn about how climates have changed in the past. There are folks who study pollen, for example, or use tree rings, or a lot of people use the records in the ocean, the marine records. And like all everything, different approaches or methods have their strengths and weaknesses. And I thought I would just mention, just briefly, highlight some of the strengths that we feel are in using glaciers to look at past climates versus pollen or tree rings or ocean records. And one of the key strengths for us is that the glaciers are really sensitive recorders of the past atmosphere. They directly record what atmospheric characteristics or past climates were like. For example, there are no biologic effects which may complicate the signals in other proxies. Glaciers don't compete with each other for survival, if you will. They're a direct expression of what the former atmosphere was like. I have this elephant got cut off on the bottom. This is our colleague Andrew McIntosh talks about the elephant effect. Oh, there's no beam. And what I thought I'd just mention the elephant effect. And what the elephant effect is, when you have a large area where the climate can change, it can affect a large area. So a given climate change, a cooling or a warming, causes a vast area to change, and that's kind of amplified or funneled, if you will, through a glacier or a narrow glacier. So this, if there's a huge change up here in how much snow or temperature affects up here, this glacier will really feel it because it's kind of that effect is all being funneled through kind of a narrow glacier valley. So we really, the purpose is to also highlight that when we're looking for new records, and I'll come back to that at the end, we don't just go into any valley or any place and say, well, let's look for evidence of what the glaciers did. We look for places where the changes, the evidence could be quite comprehensive, or the glaciers, both present and past, could be quite sensitive to how the climate's changed. And that's not equal everywhere. So this is just to help you understand or appreciate what, you know, places where the glaciers are more sensitive to let's say, given climate change or a large area. This is just a slide to just mention or highlight. I keep saying we want to learn about past climates or how past climates have changed. And this is just to help us appreciate what, when I say past climates or present climates, what we're even talking about. Oops, sorry, I keep mentioning. Here in Santiago, as folks already know, that, you know, we're mainly affected by the subtropical climates on short time scales, El Niño, for example. But this helps you appreciate that as you go south to Punta Arenas and the University of Magallanes, we're much more affected by the climate, what's happening around Antarctica, and the weather systems moving from the polar region. So it's Chile is a good place to look at the transition from the more subtropical climates to the more polar climates, and really learn about how these different systems are behaving, both past and present. I thought I'd spend a few minutes, or a minute or two, just talking about how we date glacial deposits in the past. So I mentioned I study how glaciers have changed in the past. As geologists, many of us struggle over much of our career on how to figure out when this happened. So if we go to a valley and we find some deposits left by a former glacier when it was more expansive, how do we know its age? How do we determine how old these deposits are? And I mention this because this is an important part of my time here as a Fulbright scholar. And just to introduce the technique that I focus on with colleagues, the technique is called cosmogenic surface exposure dating, or cosmogenic dating. It sounds sort of new age, and you know, if that helps us, we'll say it sounds new age. And the basis for this method, or this dating technique, is that the cosmic rays, mainly protons, are entering our atmosphere at all times from all directions. They're not so much from the sun, they're just left over from, we're not really sure what their cause is, but they're probably related to the origin of the galaxy or the supernova explosions. But the point is, these cosmic rays, shown by these lines, enter our atmosphere at all times. And once they enter the Earth's atmosphere, they start colliding with things, molecules in the atmosphere, rocks, our skin, sometimes feel it, claws, the pavement, anything exposed to the air will be hit by cosmic rays. And what the cosmic rays do is they hit a mineral. You can see my artistic drawing of a mineral. And they change the chemistry in the surface of whatever they're hitting. So a cosmic ray may hit an oxygen atom in a mineral, a rock, or oxygen in our skin, and it will convert it to another isotope. We'll break it apart, creating something, for example, beryllium-10, which we happen to be using. So if we know how fast these chemical reactions take place in a given year, we have a geologic dating tool. We can go back and say, how much is there now, and divide it by X atoms created per year, and it tells us a rock has been exposed to the air for 30,000 years or 100 years. So anyway, I actually had a video I put together with a Dill School of Journalism, but I could show that later if this time on the technique. But nice pictures. This of these are glacial deposits. This is near Coyhaique, and this is something we call moraine. This is near Lago Argentino. And this crest is just a bunch of deposits left by a glacier when it was much more expansive. Some of you may have seen moraines if you've been up in the mountains, in the Rocky Mountains, or around here in Maipo. And this is just, you see, we just take a piece of the surface. And so these boulders that we're sampling have been exposed to the atmosphere since the glacier left them on the landscape. And so we're collecting our sample and determining how long they've been exposed to the air. Now, why is this important? Or the rest of the talk kind of segues into what I'm doing here and some of the objectives over the next 4 months, or I'm actually almost a month in already. And just to give you a short history lesson, since we have historians in the audience, when I was a student, which I like to say was not too long ago, although the years are increasing, we had a rule of thumb that this technique I just described to you, where rocks exposed to the atmosphere, we can measure how long the chemical changes have been taking place. It was only good for kind of long time periods, way back, like when the last ice age happened. These changes, these chemical changes that I just said, are very slow. So we didn't really have the technology recently until to measure, except for long time periods in the geologic record. Well, over the last 10 years, that's all changed. At the place I'm at, Lamont Doherty Earth Observatory, and some other folks, the technologies and the methods have really advanced to the point where we can now look at a boulder deposited by, this is a glacier now for the Taurus Alpine, that was deposited 100, 150 years ago, and determine when exactly this boulder was deposited by this glacier when it was much larger, sitting at this moraine crest. This has just been in the last 10 years or so. Before that, the method, when I was a PhD student, we used to say, well, the method's good. When did the last ice age happen in the Andes or Arctic, 20,000 years ago or 17,000 years ago? Well, now we're looking at changes over the last few hundred years. And why is this important? Because it allows us all of a sudden to address a bunch of new questions about how the climate's changed that were just not available more than 10 years ago. So when I was a student, we can now look at we can ask questions how the glaciers have fluctuated and waxed and waned over the last few hundred years, or the last few thousand years, not just like when did the last ice age happen. And as you can appreciate, this really opens up a new set of questions and whatnot. It also allows us to reach this ultimate goal, start to overlap with other approaches, which was not previously possible. So for example, here's my boulder, that's a little me in New Zealand. We can now overlap with people who look at tree rings, dendrochronology, which is good for the last few hundred years. And so this is a goal. I'm working with somebody in University of Magallanes, Juan Carlos, who's a tree ring person. He's also working with Esteban and I at North. We can even just start to overlap with instrumental records. So the point is, this really allows us to go from the instrumental record, which is about 100, 150 years at best, back to hundreds of thousands or millions. It allows us to tie the past, which has been my expertise, with present changes in a way that's not possible. So this is really something to I'm thinking about while here in Chile. This is just an example. So this is the Uppsala Glacier. This is a nice Google Earth image, and it just helps you. We published this last year as kind of a proof of concept that the method works in Patagonia. And just to walk you through this, this blue line represents where the Uppsala Glacier was. It's a spelling mistake, but ignore that. And where the Uppsala Glacier was about 4,000 or 5,000 years ago, so it covered all this landscape. And then these are these cosmogenic ages of 600 years ago, 200 years ago, and the white line basically represents where the Uppsala Glacier was during the last 600 years. And of course, it's waxing and waning, but it's coming out to these positions. So this just gives you an example of how we look at a modern glacier and learn what it's done before historical or during historical time. I mean, in this case, you know, we're starting to get, as Peter said, we're starting to get people already settling in the region and how the climate's changed during this time. So this is my last main slide. So some themes or goals or things I'm thinking about while here to wrap some of these things together. We published this last year, but what I like to say is we've barely scratched the surface. We've shown it works. We can do this really well. It's not easy, but nothing's easy, right? That's worthwhile. And what I'd like to do is while here, working with new colleagues and people I have known for a while, is start to apply this more widely, both in Southern South America and also perhaps around here, moving north. And so the I just showed you pictures from Uppsala, and I just spent the last 10 days around Cochrane and the San Lorenzo Fashionau area where I'm working with Esteban. And we're going to go to Darwin in April. That's our big expedition. And what I'm thinking about is we've now shown it works, and to establish the next 5 to 10 years plus of research, really start to work with new students, think of new areas. I mentioned that we don't just go into any area. We have to think about which areas are important, and set up for me the next 5 to 10 plus years of research. And it takes time to find good sites. And one of the great things about being down here as a Fulbright scholar for so many months is it gives me the time to think about where the best places are for the next 5 to 10 plus years to work. A lot of times you come down, you can only come down a week or two during spring break or between teaching classes. It's quite difficult. And this will be about 75% más o menos of my time. Yeah, this is really going to be the most of the time. But I've been talking about how we really want to link the past and present better together. Now that these techniques are allowing us to say what glaciers did over the last few hundred years, it's allowing me to think more about the present and the last more historical time. And so while here, especially when I'm in Santiago in May and June, I want to start to do two things. One is to learn more about how, in the modern sense, how glaciers and climate interact, and the nitty-gritty details about how climate actually affects glaciers, etc. And there's the Chilean experts, including here in Santiago and down in Valdivia, are an excellent resource for me to learn about this. And also, I know very little about the human dimensions of glaciers and climate. I'm a geologist. And this is a good opportunity. Damn it, Jim, I'm a geologist. I'm a sociologist. And this is a good opportunity for me to understand much better the societal relevance, superficially, of course, I talk about the importance of glaciers and climate to society. But while here, I'm hoping to just start to introduce myself or start to learn about the more the human dimensions of glaciers, climate, society. And of course, number three is the teaching the short courses, which we're all doing in all these topics. And one more slide. And this is just the two main institutions I'm at, which I've already mentioned. And some of the, at least initial folks I hope to work with during the year. And the last thing I want to mention is I'm actually not a permanent tenured professor. I'm a grant-based, a soft money scientist, we say in the US. I'm grant-based. And what this means is everything I do basically has to relate to where I get my salary from, which is grants. And the Fulbright is just an excellent, for me it's excellent because it's given me a concentrated period of time where I don't have to worry next week the salaries from that grant and the following week. It's just allowing me to have a 4-month period where I can really think about these questions to make some major headway in these issues, especially being that my salary when I'm in the U.S. is always tied to specific grants. The Fulbright's really good for me, a good opportunity for me to pursue these things. Thanks.
Michael, I just wanted to introduce myself. I'm Chris Nice, I'm a science officer at the embassy. And I wanted to thank you for the very clear presentation. When you're back in May and June, maybe we could set up a time to meet. I'd just like to learn more about your research and your findings and introduce you to some of the people who I've been working with over the last 2.5 years on some of these issues. I apologize because I have to run to a meeting. So thank you for the presentation. Have a good day.
Thanks. Yeah.
I was wondering with your isotope technique, what if the rock gets covered with algae or lichen or snow or dust? Does that cause you to underestimate?
We try to, it doesn't, I tried to apply the technique in rainforests.
Uh-huh.
Actually, I tried a long time ago, 15 years ago in Chile. It doesn't work so well because of the forest floor. A little bit of lichen cover, lichens are so thin, they don't, this just goes, that doesn't work really. Moss mats or these things could start to shield. So the cosmic rays make it down to about 1 meter.
Uh-oh.
Most of the stuff is in the top skin, but they do make it down to 1 meter, and moss is so thin it has no effect. But we start to worry about moss mats and these things, and trees and stuff don't seem to matter. The big thing about trees is they collect snow, and yes, snow will shield the rock. You need a lot of snow for a long period of time. It is something we worry about, like in New England, when we use this technique in New England. But some of the places I'm working at, what we try to do is get the boulders at least 1 or 2 meters off the ground, for example, because then the snowpack is usually not that thick. Or if it is, it's only for a month or two, which is not enough to. So yeah, these things will shield. So we consider these things as we collect our sample. We'll never collect a boulder in a depression between two moraines, for example, because those are the places where you get the thick snow that lasts for months. Usually when we're on top of these ridges, they're wind swept a little bit. So this is something we always make a note of, but the snow has been shown to be a problem in places like the Alps or the Pacific Northwest, where you really long, thick packs for a long period of time.
So maybe there's not enough room to discuss this right now, but during the presentation you mentioned that, you know, when you were a student, you had a resolution of about 10,000 years. For this technique, and now you're down to 100 years. I mean, that's a huge difference. Do you mind, could you expand a little bit on how it's advanced, or is that?
So there's two main reasons why the technique is we can do things now that we couldn't do when I was a student in the 90s. And one is that the laboratory processing is much better. We've gotten the background. You know, every laboratory is going to have some level of background contamination that gets in the way, and that's usually the baseline. You can't go any lower. That's gotten better. We've learned in the laboratories how to get our, we call them the blanks, down much lower. And what that means is when your background contamination is much lower, you can measure much lower concentrations of these chemical changes. The second thing is we use machines called accelerator mass spectrometers, and just simply the technology has gotten better over the last 10 to 20 years. So that the two things, the laboratory methods have gotten better. We've learned how to do our laboratory work in a way that allows us to measure much, much smaller amounts of changes in the surface of the rock because our backgrounds are lower in our labs. And the machine folks who run the spectrometers, who do the actual measurements for us, have gotten, their technologies just get better. Actually, an interesting story is these techniques started, sorry, 30 second story. The techniques came online really in the 1980s as the Cold War was sort of winding up. They had these big machines that the nuclear physicists used for decades during the Cold War research, and they were becoming obsolete because they were building smaller machines to do the same kind of research. And some folks were smart enough to realize that these big machines that had been used during the Cold War to build, to do research for bombs could be used for earth science applications. And so it was the 1980s where these things really started to take off. So if there was any benefit of the Cold War, it was I could do brilliant 10 dating on boulders laid down by glaciers 10,000 years ago. And so in the last 10 or 20 years, as there's been more focus on the earth science applications of these machines, not just because we could convert them, then the technologies. So it's really those two things, the measurement itself and the laboratory.
Thank you.
Thank you.